Our next speaker has a very provocative title for his talk. This is not your father's pesticide. 2 decades of advances toward a safer technology. Professor Allan Felsot is professor at Washington State University. He is now focusing his work on risk assessments of environmental contaminants. He's done work for the American Chemical Society's Agro Division as vice chair. He has been close to my heart, a Fulbright scholar. And one thing we never thought we'd be putting on our bios when we were young men is that he's a member, he got an honorary award from the State Weed Association.
Okay, thank you very much. So Joe called me and said, I need somebody to talk about the technology, where it's gone. So I said, okay, yeah, I'll be happy to do that. I don't have to teach and manage the graduate program in environmental sciences, and it'll be like a little vacation. Then I looked at the agenda, and since I teach a couple of different environmental toxicology courses and try to stay really in touch with all the current literature, and by the way, Professor, I'm amazed you went through your talk and didn't mention the word epigenetics there, because that was a very nice illustration of something a faculty member at my university has published on, but those were the lowest doses I've ever seen, so that's a real interesting research. Which is to say that when I looked at the agenda, I realized I was the patsy, because I probably have some contrarian views. But let me take you through the information about the technology. So what you would see is this fog of from a truck, and just with these fogs and whatnot, it's all DDT. So I was a kid in the 1950s, and I'm sure I was exposed, and my mother smoked, and I'm sure there was some epigenetic effects there, and probably can explain a lot of my anti-establishment, anti-authoritarian aspects to my personality. So obviously these things do have an effect. But I'm here to tell you that things have changed a lot, and I'm really glad that the dean actually mentioned that story about the book Brainwash and talked about the 17 applications a year to apples, and I can tell you I live right next to a 1,000-acre apple orchard and other crops on the eastern side of the mountains, and that's absolutely not true. And so with all due respect, this what I'm here to talk about is where are we now? You know, a lot of the studies are actually looking at stuff that was then, which is fine, but let's look at the technology as it is now. And part of the technology it is now is we're using a lot more natural products. So we're using proteins from Bacillus thuringiensis, as shown up here, and this was discovered actually in the early 1900s, but now with our techniques of cellular biology and evolving into microbiology, we now know exactly what these proteins are, and I'll show you just how many of them are. And also there was a little nice bacterium found in an old rum distillery soil in the Virgin Islands, and lo and behold, there's a group of compounds called spinosyn, which eventually got marketed or developed anyways for certified organic agriculture, which is great if you're growing cherries and you have a problem with Western cherry fruit fly. So this is actually used by both so-called conventionals and organics. But of course, we now have learned exactly what genes are, you know, causing transcription translation to the protein level, and we now realize that due to physical thermodynamic principles, we realize what DNA can actually do, and when you chop it up, and how it reanneals, and all this cool stuff, and so we can actually trick a plant genome into expressing these. And by the way, a lot of my comments are going to be related to insecticides. I'm sure you'll get your fill of herbicides tomorrow, and 2 talks that will be coming up. So I'm just talking about insecticides today. That's pretty much historical controversy, but there's others. And of course, now registered as pesticides are the actual pheromones. So we know a lot about pheromones. It's mostly the butterflies and the moths that use these pheromones, but there's a few other important species. And now we put these into little twisty tie kind of things, and we hang them in orchards, a lot of hand labor, but boy, they do a really good job as long as you start with a low enough population density of certain moth pests, like the codling moth. That's the biggest problem. Some things, though, have not changed. So malaria is still a big problem in the world. Latest statistics from WHO indicate approximately 800,000 people die, less than 100,000 children die. And there's actually 7 million new and recurring cases of this every year transmitted by Anopheles mosquitoes. We're very fortunate, but We are definitely not an island, so in 1999, when the West Nile virus was found in the Northeast, it didn't take too long before it's now found everywhere. Fortunately, they developed a serum, a vaccine for horses, but nothing for humans. How big of a risk is it? It's all arguable, but it's there. And of course, we always get new pest invaders, the Drosophila suzuki. Now, Drosophila, we probably know, is a little vinegar flies, and when we have fruit out too long, we see these little things falling around, and we think, oh my God, spontaneous generation is real, but no, they're there all the time. They've laid their eggs. But now we have a pest that's invaded from Asia, that has an ovipositor with a rasp on it, and it can actually puncture fruit, whereas the regular Drosophila melanogaster can't do that. So now we have to deal with that in our soft fruit. Okay, so we have the same old pests, and we got new ones. So why am I arguing that there was a change? And I will argue that it was not government regulations that promoted this change. So DDT was a pretty good public health pesticide during World War II. Saved a lot of lives. But some people had the thought that, oh my gosh, it kills insects at such low levels, let's use it for agriculture and spray it every damn place. And I can tell you as an entomologist, that was the wrong thing to do. And it wasn't long into the early 50s when entomologists, mainly from the University of California Riverside, realized, my gosh, this is wrong for agriculture. Maybe good for controlling malaria, but this stinks for agriculture. And what was happening was they would get this phenomenon that we call pest resurgence. And what that means is, in a couple weeks, the pests are back again at even a higher density because we don't realize that the life cycle of the pest is much faster than the life cycle of the so-called natural enemies. Those are the parasitoids, mostly wasps, and the predators. And so we were screwing up the regulation, natural regulation. And then, of course, pest resistance. There had only been a couple examples of pest resistance occurring, insect resistance to something. And now, boy, the things came really quickly resistant to DDT. So really bad deal. And then the cotton cushion scale was the hallmark benchmark case because the Vidalia beetle, lady beetle, had been imported years and years ago. It got the cotton cushion scale on citrus, all nice and regulated. You didn't have to do anything after a while. It was established, and it completely screwed up that system. So long before Rachel Carson, actually the entomologists were saying, no, this is not a good idea. And what happened is by 1959, they produced this report called the Integrated Control Concept. And the most important point about this report is that, hey, look, you know, a field is not a field, it's an agro-ecosystem. And so we have to take an ecological viewpoint on this. Now, there was a real reality here. Yes, you may need a chemical technology, but what you have to do is you have to make it compatible, complementary to the biological aspects of the system. And what does that mean? It means low persistence, so the chemical disappears quickly. But the most important thing is selectivity. So I'm going to be talking about selectivity. Okay. Now, ironically, DDT has a silver lining. And a silver lining is because it got us from a system out of control, realizing it really early in the 1950s, to the integrated control concept and then evolving into integrated pest management. It was realized that you needed more than just a chemical technology complementary to a biological control, but you needed a lot of other possible techniques too. We call these preventative techniques. Okay, so EPA got a bad rap here. So in 93, they had this policy of promoting what they called reduced risk. Now, I should tell you, historically, in the late 70s, this word biorational was invented. It was actually invented by an industry dude, okay? And what did that mean? It meant basically thinking about how you can control pests in a selective manner by taking advantage of the very specific biochemistry of insects, where it is specific. There's a lot of commonalities with vertebrates. In 1996, when the Food Quality Protection Act was passed, there was also a mandate to develop the reduced risk program. Now, here's the ironic thing. So by 1997, a year after the act was passed, EPA had already approved 22 new active compounds that they called, quote, reduced risk. Now, reduced risk is not a scientific concept. It's a social concept. Okay, so let's get that straight right now. I'll try to define it in a sense here. Well, how did this happen? Well, that meant that somebody in industry must have been paying attention to the selectivity issue and getting the kinds of properties that would meet the reduced risk standard. Okay, so things were happening, and you know, you don't see them until after they're already out on the market, maybe. So what does it mean? Well, first of all, reduced risk can only be measured in terms of relative to what? Relative to the organophosphates, relative to the old DDT stuff and things like that. But basically, this is the list. It's the list of everything you would like. If it was preceded by no impact on human health, no toxicity, et cetera, everybody would be fine. We wouldn't have this conference and have to find something else to do, but in a sense, you can only look at it in a relative thing. In other words, we're evolving. All right. So again, here, this is different computers, but I just want to point out something else that's very important. Now, I'm not saying that pesticides is responsible for this, but pesticides are just a tool. But this is what we've done. We've been able to take less land and grow a lot more food. And certainly, breeding is part of this. But pesticides are just one tool. They contribute to it, but they are not the cause of that. They only protect yields. They don't increase yields. Now, I don't have to tell you that pesticides have a really bad rap. So how do we get off this treadmill of not understanding what the technology is, or at least going to a place where we can have a better technology, you know, that we can, you know, live with it, so to speak. And I want to kind of think the argument out of the box here. And I got this idea that we need to think more like a plant. So what does a plant do? Well, they've been around for eons. Flowering plants have been on Earth for about 140 million years. We've only been here a very short blink of an eye, if that. And so what are they doing right? From the plant's viewpoint, it's an insect-eat plant world out there. They can't run away from their enemy, so to speak. So basically, they become these chemical factories. They've devoted a lot of their energy into secondary metabolic pathways to produce these compounds that will affect the behavior and outright kill certain predators or herbivores of them. For example, solanine. You know, this is an acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, and so potatoes make that. Also, unleashes crops make it. Nicotine and tobacco. That's an acetylcholine receptor agonist, and then urushiol and poison ivy. These are some of the examples. Plants are ingenious. Some of them produce a compound called lecithin that's a response to feeding by a caterpillar, and this volatile material then calls in its natural enemy, which is a little wasp that stings it with an egg and eats it from the inside out. This is brilliant, brilliant technology that's evolved. And of course, we take advantage of some of this technology and we actually make medicines out of them. I don't need to tell you, this is, you know, fairly well known. And actually, they've inspired the template for some of our modern compounds. Although the physostigmine up there, that's the methyl carbamate group, but that's probably on its way out too. But the pyrethrins, which are two of the many components in the pyrethrums extract, chemists back in the 60s started twiddling around with the compound, changing this, changing that, made it a little bit more stable to UV so you can actually use it as an ag compound. Of course, pyrethrins are used, certified for organic agriculture. All right, so I have this idea that what we need to be moving towards is synergy, doing more with less, and I think plants exhibit that synergy between biology and chemistry. So here are some examples. We've transitioned from broad spectrum insecticides with uncertain risk to selective chemicals with so-called reduced risk. We transitioned from insecticide where we used to use these things at tens of pounds per acre. And I don't know if you've ever seen an application of a pesticide. That's pretty amazing, to fractions of a pound per acre. Literally, you need to measure these in grams to really get a feel for it. We're transitioning from insecticide with common modes of actions in insects and vertebrates to more specificity. And we're moving from synthetics to engineered biological entities. So we're using less, and what we're using is more selective. And I'm talking about what's going on today. Ideal of synergy with all honors to Buckminster Fuller. Okay, so again, these are the ideals for reduced risk in the EPA program. Okay, now, here's the irony. There's a number of compounds. Well, first of all, let me say that there's compounds on the bottom there that are biochemically selective. The endocrine system in insects is different for the most part. I mean, there's some commonalities, but there's some very specific aspects to the biochemistry of the endocrine system in insects. So there's compounds that address those issues, and they're highly selective. Ironically, there's those it's possible through the concept of agents out there. And there's several different biochemical mechanisms of selectivity. For example, one is the non-target organism might lack the appropriate biochemical receptor or the enzyme target. That's one way. But what if there is a commonality in the biochemical receptor? Maybe you have a difference in potency. By that, I would define that as you have poor binding or interaction with the biochemical target. I'll show you an example of that. And then you can have very quick detoxification of the compound. Now, I want to add one more thing. It's more of a social thing. That's the operations. How do we use these things? How do we deploy them? Can we use them smarter to reduce any hazards? So let me show you a little bit of, quote, biochemistry. This comes from John Cassada, famous toxicologist at the University of California, Berkeley. And here, acetamiprid and dinotafuran are classified as reduced risk. They're in this class called neonicotinoids, also known as chlorinicotinols. And they work just like their nicotine. Nicotine sits on the acetylcholine receptor and begins to cause firing of adjacent nerves. And everybody's familiar with nicotine. And one way to look at selectivity is to look at the potency, and the potency is related to the binding properties to the receptor. So you can do this little experiment, basically extract out the central nervous system and mix it up with these compounds, and what you do is you see how much of it displaces the natural neurotransmitter, acetylcholine. And when you look at nicotine, the way to look at this is the higher numbers means the binding potential relatively is much, much lower than with the lower number. In other words, it just takes a fewer molecules to have really good complementary binding and to tip off the reaction. And then what you do is you look at an insect compared to a vertebrate. And so when you look at nicotine, what that's telling me there, when you look at the selectivity ratio, make the ratio, the numbers less than one are really bad. Nicotine is an extremely toxic compound. It also it gets through the skin really easily. That's why nicotine patches work. And that would be very dangerous if an insecticide did that. But when you look at these reduced risk things, basically they have extremely low potency because they don't bind to the receptor. We know in an insect they work on that receptor, but in the vertebrate receptor, the complementary is just not there. The levels are actually used in the environment, there shouldn't really be any problem for people. If they have to wear the protection, though, of course, every time. This is a list of all of the, not all of them, but this is a selected list of reduced risk insecticides that EPA has approved over the last decade. And, you know, we don't really use acute toxicity parameters like the LD50s, dermal. I look at dermals when I'm dealing with applicators because dermals tell me, you know, what the propensity for getting it on your hands and hazard is. So it tells me something. When they're in the thousands, we don't get too concerned. But what we're interested in is the so-called no observable effect level, which also got a bad rap. And I actually would like to talk about that a little bit if I had the time, but I won't right now. But you could look at it comparatively. Look at what we had, glutathione, azinphos, methyl, chlorpyrifos. Look how small those values are compared to the other values there. So you see, in a comparative sense, we're moving in the right direction. By the way, again, EPA gets a bad rap for not doing anything, but they're the ones that said we will not be allowed to use azinphos, methyl in our orchards after this summer. You know, it's arguable from a scientific standpoint, but from a policy standpoint, it's gone. Okay, so how are we doing with this group of compounds? In blue there, that's all the ones that were classified as reduced risk from that table. So this is a logarithmic scale, just to give you a perspective there. This is the LC50, the lethal concentration to 50% of a fish population after a four-day constant exposure study. And you can see there that there's quite a big difference for what we used to use or is going on its way out and what we use now. You see the same thing with birds. Indoxacarb is the one exception. It's a little bit weird. But again, you got to go back to, well, how do you actually use indoxacarb? It's actually not even used that much. And then this goes to the point that we use a lot less of these things than we used to use. All right, so the transition, and you can see here in the difference in almost 20 years, we're using a lot different compounds. And the good news is we're getting rid of the OPs. And when the last OP goes, great. I'll be very, very happy since I don't want to talk about it anymore. It's kind of boring. Okay. We're in this era of biological engineering, with all due respect to Chuck Benbrook, who's going to speak next. I'm sure he'll give you his earful. But I've been teaching agricultural entomology among many courses for a number of years, and agricultural entomology is kind of a combination of applied ecology, integrated pest management theory, pest biology, which is what we do in the labs. And of course, we have to get to the management side after getting through all the other side. And we talk about prevention first. So we put a lot of emphasis on preventative methods. And we basically can either lower pest density or we can reduce what we call economic damage level. And in both of those, there's something in common, and that is plant insect-resistant cultivars. Now, this is a real ideal. Organic growers would love to have insect-resistant or pathogen-resistant cultivars, but it's not easy to get there. What are one of the objectives of crop breeding? Well, it's always been resistance to insects and other pests. History, Everybody's familiar with the history, but what I want to point out is hybridization was a big thing in the 30s. And by the 40s, just about every corn farmer in the United States was using hybridization because the quality of what they were getting was far superior than the single line open pollinated cultivars. And of course, we've been tweaking genes using mutagenesis of embryos for a very long time. No one seemed to be concerned about it. But when it got to actually moving a specific gene around, we got a lot of controversies about that. So I'll just mention transgenic crops, and I'll show you that transgenic crops have been widely adopted in the United States. All right. Now, the fact that I show you this, don't mistake this for evidence of safety, nor evidence that's a good thing. I'm not saying that, but what I do want, I am here to talk to you about the science, and we know a lot about this organism from which these genes originate. And there's many, many varieties of this organism. I can't even say they're actual different species. It's all one species anymore. The concept of species in the prokaryotes is going by the wayside. But here, you know, by the 50s and 60s, we knew exactly where this protein was. Now, here's the amazing thing about Mother Nature. When this was prepared, these were all the known different types of proteins. They're all homologous proteins, so the genes vary a little bit in the different subcultures or subtypes of the... And now we know that there's over 300. So this is a cladogram, and it tells us the phylogenetic relationships among all these organisms. And new ones are being found all the time. Now we're into the so-called VIPs instead of the CRI proteins. But the main message is, this is a 2001 slide, we know the biochemistry of this really well. We know what specific receptors to the specific insects that this is attacked. So this has all been very well worked out, and even the knowledge about how these things work in insects is actually advanced now. If I got you a more recent slide, I'd show you another little picture to this puzzle. So the science is we know pretty well what's going on, and you don't really hear about that unless you're reading that literature. My third case is we're getting smarter at delivery. So what that means is, how do we use this? Can we formulate it as a bait and not have to spray it? Systemic properties, and I know that's going to be controversial with bees and imidacloprid, but that's an issue that actually goes back well over a decade. And then, can we apply it to restricted zones and not spread everywhere, as well as the time of day? By the way, when it comes to neonicotinoids, imidacloprid, other ones, you're not allowed to spray these things when plants are flowering, okay? That's a violation of federal law, so just bear that in mind. Okay, well, I just want to give you one example, and here's the sort of the switch and bait technique to trick out termites. This only works on subterranean termites, but basically what you do is you take that compound over there, hexafluoride. It's a chitin synthesis inhibitor, and so that pathway for chitin synthesis is pretty specific to insects. It doesn't affect the pathway in fungi. They have chitin in their cell walls. But what you do is basically make little holes around the house in strategic locations, put a piece of wood, the subterraneans come up from the colony, they see the wood, they start feeding on it, take it back, and you know they know that's the source. Then what you do is you have a technician monitors when they know the termites are finding that wood. You switch out the wood with hexafluoride-baited wood. The workers take it back to the colony, feed the queen, and boom, that ends egg production because eggs have to have chitin in the cuticle that surrounds them. And so without spraying anything, without getting the stuff in the house and whatnot, it takes about a year, but you can take care of these subterranean termites. So smarter delivery. We now have these gels that literally you can go along a baseboard and just put down a little plop of gel. So ants, cockroaches, they like those baseboard areas. That's where they'll come from. And they just walk across one little droplet, boom, they're dead. So you don't have to spray a whole house anymore with these new things. Let me throw out something. Isn't putting the protein of BT in a plant, isn't that kind of a selective delivery technique? But more importantly, isn't that post-plant resistance? Think about that. Okay, now, all this is going to be ephemeral, though, and this is always my main message to people in the industry, is that if we over-rely on one technique, we're going to fail. And we got lots of examples of that. And actually, there's a big example of that has nothing to do with pesticides, but has to do with cultural control, rotating crops, and how that's failed with the western corn rootworm in the Midwest. And nothing will last unless we have an IPM frame of mind. So Crop protection tools are not substitutes for IPM, they're just little pieces that have to be complementary with everything else in the system. That's it, thank you.